Here.
Monahan?
Here.
Horn?
Here.
Nelson?
Here.
Jones?
Here.
And Keel is absent with notice.
Do we have any additions to the agenda? If not, I'll look for a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? You're none. All right. Look for approval of the minutes of previous meetings from 12/20/2016.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
Yeah, there was some discussion. Did you want to address that, Scott, or not?
Go ahead.
You want me to address it?
Actually, what was the, what was it again, Monahan? I just wish I had some chat about it.
It was the vote to approve John McMahon planning zoning. And my conversation with Scott, the way it reads is Scott voted no. But I think it would be beneficial to put in there that Scott voted no because there wasn't a call for discussion. If that makes any sense.
How about we go with this on the grounds for additional discussion? Let's do that. Okay?
Nelson voting no on the grounds.
On the grounds.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just for clarification.
Yeah.
So it kind of reads like Scott didn't want him.
I know.
So.
Thank you.
We need to make a motion.
No, we've got a motion in a second.
I'll make a substitute motion to approve the minutes with the following change.
Second.
More discussion. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? You're none.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you.
All right, next would be approve any bills submitted for payment if there are any. See any? It passed, and 7:03 for the 7:05 hearing. So what we'll do is we're going to jump down to the ordinances just for a moment here. We've got ordinance 634, the 2015 International Residential Code.
I'll make a motion to approve ordinance 634, Residential Code, 2015.
Second.
I'm going to make a substitute motion.
Okay.
To kick this back to the new Planning and Zoning Board for their review.
We got that. Do we have a second on the substitute motion?
A second for discussion.
Okay, discussion.
Have they already looked at this?
What's that?
Has P&Z already looked at this?
The board before the change over here in January has reviewed, yeah. They've spent weeks looking at them. Each week we take one of the ordinances, go over it, review it, talk about the various changes. Paul Clark was always present to discuss what changes were made, if any, how they pertain to the contractors. I think Mark's suggesting maybe the new members of the P&Z board. Okay.
Well, the new members are the ones that are going to have to live by it.
When they reviewed these, you said they take each week, they go over one of them. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. So these have been through, taking a couple of meetings to get to this point where we've got the three that we've got here.
It probably took a couple months. We took, discuss, and then we did a review of all of them at a meeting, and actually kind of took a couple meetings so they could read them, you know, thoroughly and look at it, so we took a little bit of a review by them.
You to go through them then, okay?
What's the likelihood that they'll, I guess, the surrounding neighborhoods have all approved these, correct?
Yeah, this, they follow exactly, we haven't changed anything or deviated from Sioux Falls or Brandon, every county, it's, you know, we've adopted exactly what they've adopted, or suggesting to adopt what they've adopted.
Okay.
Okay. More discussion on that?
We're not under a timeframe to adopt, are we?
Just gotta change all the dates in the ordinances, that's okay. No, we're not.
How often do we adopt these, do you have?
Every 3 years.
Is that okay if I just come?
Yeah, you should, yeah.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay, all right, thanks. Basically, just to give an overview, I think I know a bunch of right here. So I'm the building official for Hartford, and they're adopted every 3 years. So the National Code Council, and probably 99% of the jurisdictions in the United States have adopted these codes. It's only Sioux Falls, Brandon, Minnehaha County have adopted them already. Sioux Falls adopted them in May of 16. They usually wait about a year. So this code is a 2015 code, and it rolled out in the winter, it's coming in the spring of 15. Sioux Falls has historically waited about a year to let the dust settle. Sometimes the ICC folks, after they adopt a code, will come back and make some revisions. Sioux Falls wants to let all that dust settle. So their team will go through it. Obviously, they have a large staff over there, and they'll review these adjustments as long as I will review on behalf of the city of Hartford, and have done that, and have had discussions with Ron Bell, the building official, about the adjustments. So you have a thick book that comes through, and then there's adjustments to that book from the 12 code to the 15 code, which we're going to. And the cities can adopt them across the board, or they can make amendments. And Ron Bell historically has made some amendments. And as Teresa mentioned, the Minnehaha County, Brandon, and the jurisdictions around have always taken those amendments along with them for the consistency for the contractors. So if you have a Rodney Homes or a Paul Fick Homes, if you have 20 homes a year, I'm just throwing a number out, obviously. You know, the majority will be built in Sioux Falls, and there'll be a couple built here. Maybe one built in Humboldt, a couple in Brandon. But it allows that contractor to be consistent, so they don't have to remember, wait a minute, I'm going over to Hartford. They're not on the same program, and then they have to remember changes, and it makes it difficult. Contractor, as well as the building inspector, that, you know, he's got to follow these rules, and it's a little bit different than Sioux Falls. So, but I'm in constant contact with the county building official as well as the city of Sioux Falls to make sure we're always interpreting correctly. And if there's a difficulty with one, we'll go to the national court. So, to answer your question, we're already, and obviously in 2017, the 2018 code's been rolled out, you know, within about 12 months. The sooner we can get these on board, not that the Hartford will adopt 18 codes in the winter of 18 coming up, but I would think within 12 months after that, we probably will be. And what's also consistent is that these homes are built, being built, you know, at a higher engineering level, at a better safety level. That's what the codes do every 3 years nationally. They're getting feedback. And so, you know, we want these homes to be built as soon as we can in Hartford to the 15 code. So, you know, it's certainly an administrative thing. We can go through that if that's what your choice is. I prefer to roll forward if we could tonight and get them adopted on board. So
did planning and zoning review the 2015 codes, or did they review the 2015 altered codes by Sioux Falls?
Well, they wouldn't have read the entire code book necessarily. They would have read the significant changes and then the amendments as well. So I provided them the significant changes from 12 to 15, plus the amendments that the city of Sioux Falls has adopted.
So what we would be voting on is the 2015 code plus the amendments made by Sioux Falls?
Yes, sir. Yes,
and that's
sir.
What Brandon adopted, and that's what the county adopted?
Yes, sir. Yes,
the
sir.
County and Brandon followed Sioux Falls' lead?
Yes, and has historically since I've been here. Right. It just makes it a lot easier. The only time that I know of, to be very frank, is Crooks. They don't take the amendments. And I get calls, even though they really don't have a building inspector over there. I get calls because people know that I'm old familiar with Crooks. And I say, Paul, what's Crooks doing over there? And I'll say, okay, we've got to go back to the original book. And I'll pull up my book and I say, they're not taking this amendment. And there's historically standard ones that Ron Bell does every time. And so he keeps it consistent with feedback from the builders. But Crooks is one that just takes the book as is. And so then the builders, they do have to remember something when they roll into that town. Because here's an adjustment over in Crooks. The guardrail distance is 4.5 inches on a guardrail between the spindles. We've done 5 inches here in Ron Bell's for like 10 years. But so if you go over there in Crooks and that guardrail is sitting at 5, that building inspector, if he's sharp, he'll say, nope, too wide, and they have to bring it back. So that builder has to go back and go, Paul, what are those guardrails over in Crooks going to be under? You better make them 4.5 because that's what the code says over there. So it'd be better if the Crooks guy went with the program. You know, I'm not saying the Sioux Falls is any better or worse than Hartford or Brandon, but they're a big player, and they do the majority of the contracting, you know, and obviously, so it's just easier for the building inspector to play along with them. There's nothing that's going to be less safe than Hartford, than Brandon, and Crooks, whatever. It's just some slight adjustments, but it's important if you're a storm inspector to know what those are. And I've talked to the mayor over there, and the Crooks, I think when they finally get a building inspector, they're going to probably go with their amendments like everybody else does. It just makes it easier.
Yeah, I appreciate your background on that. And you were, I think Teresa said this already, but you were present for a lot of this. As
I think all those discussions,
all
those
discussions.
I'll rescind my motion.
All right, so the substitute motion is rescinded. We still have the first motion to approve, and it was just for the first one, 634. If there's no further discussion, we'll call a vote. Nelson?
Yes.
Horn?
Yes.
Bergman?
Yes. You forget who I was.
I forgot who you were.
Thanks, your anger.
No, Monahan.
Yeah.
And yes. Jones.
Alright. This one.
It's been a while. This one.
You missed one.
Killed me in trouble.
Oh, crap.
Yeah, I like that. Yes.
Alright. We will. Can we do the rest of these in. Should we do them all separate as ordinances?
It'd probably be cleaner if you do it separate. Just
okay. Anywhere on that subject, we're going to go through these then. So next we got Ordinance 635, 2015, and National Property Maintenance Code.
Make a motion to approve first reading Ordinance 635.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? Monahan.
Yeah.
Jones.
Yes.
Brenneman.
Yes.
Horn.
Yes.
And Nelson.
Yes.
And Ordinance 636, the 2015 International Existing Building Code.
Move to adopt Ordinance 636.
Second.
Any discussion? Brenneman.
Yes.
Horn.
Yes.
Jones.
Yes.
Nelson.
Yes.
Monahan.
Yeah.
Okay, and Ordinance 637, the 2015 International Building Code.
Move to adopt Ordinance 637.
Second.
All right. Horn.
Yes.
Jones.
Yes.
Brenneman.
Yes.
Monahan.
Yeah.
Nelson.
Yes.
All right, now we'll go back up to the 705 hearing. Renewal of city garbage licenses. So. Dig in. Basically, it's the. Do you have this one in yours?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's.
This is for the.
Yep, for 705.
Nope.
Okay. All right.
I just got cut off.
Almost up. Okay. I don't know that it's going. It's in our packet. packet, isn't it, for the 705? Or at least not in that.
Yeah, I think we just got the.
Don't you have this notice?
I don't think I have it either.
We just got something about a liquor license. It's for January 17th is the one we got in our packet, so. So we just.
Oh, books. Did you give me that notice?
We didn't get the one for Cressman.
Yeah. The notices have all been pulled.
I think I got it.
It's all been in the newspaper. It's all been, because she sent it over. I think it's the wrong one in.
This one has all the correct dates for the 17th and that of that. I was wondering that too. I'm gonna have a lot of questions on this.
I must grab the wrong one, yeah, this is for next.
I read it twice, I'm looking at the agenda going.
Somebody should tell me this before.
So it's being posted, I know, right? I looked at notice public hearing.
It's been posted, so I think we can vote on it.
Yeah, it is posted.
This is posted for hearing on January 17th.
Yeah, this one is.
This is one of our packets.
Well, we did post one and it's out on the board and she sent it to the paper.
Well, you got it, everybody else was notified of two different things.
We can let Jared do his report and I'll go grab the notice.
We can jump back in.
Good thing we're not doing raises tonight.
All right.
You forget.
Second.
What?
Jared?
Yeah.
So we're not doing raises tonight?
You're leaving anyway.
Yeah.
You don't get one.
You don't get one.
Wait, maybe we'll vote on giving you one.
Yeah.
See, yours is automatic, it just, it happens a bunch of time with, your boss is taking care of you every year, every single year.
You signed it through your contract.
Every year, it's an increase, fancier cars, nicer guns.
Change of year next.
Kind of your hand cuts. Bigger tasers.
Yep.
All right, we'll move on.
December was relatively quiet for traffic enforcement, there looked like the night deputies did quite a bit at Highway 38 Western, looked like mostly speeding. I didn't notice any issues during the day. We had a couple snow events that, there were a number of accidents and slide-ins during some of the poor weather conditions. No major injuries in Hartford area, but had quite a few going in the ditch. Special attention, we had a number of snow tickets that were written the last couple snows. I think the majority of those have already been paid and the other ones hopefully here soon again. The new Hartford deputy is here, Deputy Ford. She'll be starting at shift change at January 14th of this year. And I just want to thank being in Hartford. I enjoyed working out here all the last 4+ years and going on 5. So I just want to say thanks for that. I enjoyed working out here and I wish you guys the best. And with that, I'll turn it over to Deputy Ford so she can introduce herself.
Thanks, Jared.
Hello. You have to forgive me. I'm suffering from a cold right now. So, but I'm Chansey. I've been with the county for August of this summer. It'll be 2 years. Prior to that, I was a trooper with the South Dakota Patrol for 7 years out in Rapid City. So, makes sense with background in law enforcement. But if you have any questions or anything, I'm pretty easily approachable, and I really look forward to being out here. So, hopefully, keep the legacy, Jared.
Did you say
legs?
Need a motion on that?
That's setting the bar, isn't it?
Yeah, well, we'll see, we'll see. So we need a vote on his raising his legacy, so but no, I do look forward to it, so it was nice meeting you also.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
Welcome to Hartford.
Yep.
Thank you.
And thank you, Jared, for
absolutely.
You've done over the years?
Yes.
Thanks, Jared.
I'll see you guys around here tonight too, so I'll make it out of the office every once in a while.
All right. Yeah, good.
Thanks, guys. See ya.
Thank you.
All right.
We'll move on to Chief Brian Schumacher, part of the fire department report.
Good evening, Mayor, Councilors. Kind of recapping December, we had 29 total calls in December, 19 of them in Hartford. In those calls in December, we did respond to 2 major structure fires. More than we'd like to, I guess. For the year, we had 272 total calls in 2016. So So, pretty good pace, but a little bit up from last year, but we've been seeing steady growth in call volume. Recapping some December training, we had classroom portion of our ice rescue training going on, and then EMS side, we had trauma practical. Coming up in January, we'll be doing CPR, defibrillator, and Lucas training, along with ice rescue practice. But yes, we're looking for volunteers that wanted to jump in the ice next weekend.
Nelson.
Not chance.
You'd be the only one here.
2017, we have a few changes in our officer corps. I'll be returning as chief for 2017. First assistant fire is Adam Erickson. First assistant rescue, Connor Orthurms. Second assistant fire, Jared Healy. Second assistant rescue, Donnie Rolfson. Secretary, Matt Horn, and treasurer, James Buss. That's our leadership team for 2017.
Good. Congratulations on chief again.
Thank you.
Are you planning on sticking around, chief, for this?
Depends on when you want to get to it, but yes, I am.
Well, if you were planning on leaving, I was going to ask you this question now, but I can ask you later when it comes to dinner.
It's on right now.
Oh, it's on right now?
Yeah. Under his report.
Oh. So we'll move. Yeah. Okay. We can go right to it. Fire Protection Services.
Jump right
agreement.
In. So, what Teresa drafted, what you and Teresa worked on. And they get everybody up to speed. I talked to Chief 2 weeks ago, last week, whatever. And he explained his concern. Use of the facility shall be with the permission of the fire chief and must be supervised by a member of the Hartford Fire and Rescue, except the use of meeting room and kitchen. Upon permission from the fire chief, the meeting room and kitchen may be used by the public unsupervised as long as there is no access to the remaining building. And I get all that. But what jumps into my head is what happens in the event that kitchen catches on fire and there's not somebody from the fire department there. How does that work strictly on an insurance basis?
And really, the kitchen use is pretty limited. It's been the chamber for the chamber breakfast at Santa Claus Day, the after school committee on Santa Claus Day, and those are really the only two groups that utilize the kitchen area.
But is your insurance going to cover that?
Yes, it would. You know, we have the full policy on.
And it doesn't matter to the insurance company who's in the kitchen?
No.
Okay. You see any problems with that, Teresa?
I know.
Okay. That was my only question.
And the only reason I brought it up to Teresa a couple weeks ago, and I apologize I was not able to be here, is I read through this, and that section really hadn't caught my eye in the past. And I guess it's our belief as a department, you know, it's a public building. We would like to see nonprofit groups that need a place to meet somewhere, have the ability to use it to go meet there, whether it's the chamber, whether it's a Cub Scout or Girl Scout troop, or some other community nonprofits that do have a place to go.
And the rest of that facility can be locked up?
Yes, and the locks are already on the doors, and we've had that practice in place.
We need approval on this, right? Motion. I'll make a motion to approve the 2017 Fire Protection Service Agreement.
With it as amended?
As amended. Apologies, yes.
Second.
Any more discussion?
So this is with the proposed wording of Section 14 that I'm looking at here, correct? The motion is.
Yes.
Brennan.
Alexander.
Morin.
Yes.
Nelson.
Yes.
Monahan.
Yeah.
Motion carries. All right. Anything else for
that? Is all I have, unless you guys have some further questions.
Nelson, you know when the shine showed up?
show up for driving into the ice.
Yeah, I'm all about that.
Thank you.
I've got one of your facts, I can tell you that.
Thanks, Steve.
We'll jump to the 705 hearing. Garbage hauling, the year 2017. Applicants are Rolac Sanitary Service, Crescent Sanitation, and RBS Sanitation.
Make a motion to approve the licenses as proposed.
I'll second.
Go ahead. Discussion?
Is, we need to put in RBS Sanitation as rollout only, or is that banned at all?
Okay. Okay. Monahan?
Yeah.
Nelson?
Yes.
Horn?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
And Brennan?
Yes.
Next is Chamber and Economic Development Director Report, Jesse.
This is always exciting.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. You're a great way to start this, thank you. In your report, we have a few highlights from the last month. The Chamber had the Hometown Christmas breakfast that we put on that morning. We raised about $500 after expenses, and we were planning to donate that money to Hartford Fire and Rescue. I think our Christmas did a great job putting in that event, and they should be commended for their hard work, because you know, the volunteer hours that goes into planning something like that weekend, it takes a lot of foresight, a lot of planning, and it's a huge benefit for this community. So we're planning on the Hartford Area Community Guide and Canvas Publications. Hope to have that out to members of the public by the end of the first quarter. They'll kind of need to mail it out to our residents and then put it in businesses in the magazine racks or whatever type of setting they have out there.
Jump in there real quick.
Yeah.
So, chamber still has the bulk mailing permit, right?
Yes, we do.
Okay. Yes, yeah, so we utilize that.
I believe so. Okay. Yeah. I don't think there's really a difference between bulk mailing permit and then the other permit, but the costs are very similar. But I do know we still have bulk.
Okay. Yeah. Cool.
Chamber elected new officers. Mitch Law will be serving president for 17. Sherry Gilbert will be vice president. Jake Colander will be the secretary. He's with Merrick Inn. And Victoria Obernauer will be the treasurer, and she's with High Rise of Sioux Falls. We have added 40 members in December. And that's about it for the chamber. For a few highlights there. For HABC, we received a request for information from GOED, probably Viber, a value-added ag facility that would employ up to 2,100 people with a possible $500 million investment. No response was made. The wastewater department is way beyond its capacity. It was about 1.8 million gallons per day, I think is what it was. Or it was way beyond what we could handle.
Jeez.
But wherever lands this, if it does kind of result, it'll be a nice benefit to the state. So I think people are working very hard at trying to get that. I think it's a meat processing facility, I think, is what had out there. HDC voted to recommend that the City of Hartford pursue a joint jurisdiction with Minnehaha County. I see it as a useful tool as the city continues to expand, and will be a benefit to the city if pursued over the next 100 years or so. Things like that make a big difference. And I believe that P&Z Board will be looking for that in January. HADC has any meeting set for Thursday, February 23rd. Tentatively at Miller Funeral Home. I just need to check with them and see if that would be okay. We'll be having a planning session for the 2017-2018 board sometime in the second quarter. Hopefully for next year, we'll have some sort of annual report to provide for you. I'm not sure what that'll look like yet, but it's something I've kind of thought about for both the chamber and the HADC to measure the organization's success, where it's at financially, kind of different metrics, so it's and how they're performing, how I'm performing, and so I've had a chance to think how that would look, but I think it's a good tool, especially for whoever comes to this position in the future to be able to look back and say, okay, they did this, cost that much, this is the contact person, or just kind of an overview of the year, It's a good foundation to lay for whatever might happen. There's a request in my, before I get to that, any questions or comments, suggestions, phrases?
You had one of the things in your bullet points there about looking at cost of land and Foundation Park.
Yeah. We did some,
No, go ahead. Yep.
We were just kind of curious what it cost. And I never reached out to the Love Foundation to ask them personally. I don't know if they would have told me or not. But I went through, I think it was the county's website and found some large land sales in that quadrant or corner. And I think the three of the big families were the Bensons, Wintersteins, and then McKenna. Across the Boys Ranch. I believe were the three largest land sellers to Foundation Park, and it costs anywhere between, I believe, $18,000 to $25,000 an acre, depending on the family line. So, of course, in the records that I found, it doesn't provide the name of the seller or the name of the buyer.
Sure.
But it was just kind of my guess based on the size of the land sales and the amount of the dollars being exchanged kind of seemed to fit. So we were just kind of curious to see what they pay for land out there and how that would translate to any sort of purchases we would be looking to make in the future outside of Hartford, because two of those parties are significant landowners outside of the Hartford city limits.
Sure. Okay. Well, thanks.
Any other comments or questions?
What's the prognosis timeline on Foundation Park? I mean, I haven't been dry. I haven't driven by it for quite some time.
I attended a meeting that was for the YPN network, which is the Young Professionals Network of Sioux Falls Area Chamber of Commerce. A couple months ago, I was seated at the table with Dean Desick, who's the Vice President of the Development Foundation. He gave us a nice little hour spiel of what's going on at Foundation Park and kind of the timeline. And I believe they're starting to finish up grading or in the grading process. They have two letters of intent, I believe. But again, letter of intent is a legally binding document, from what I understand. So as far as I know, there's nothing really developing as far as businesses out there. There was some comments about maybe in the third quarter some land might be officially sold off, purchased by different parties. I believe in 17, I think they're going to put in a water treatment plant of some sort, or some sort of water system. I'm not exactly sure, but don't quote me on it. I have my notes in my office. If you're curious about that, I can do a better in-depth answer at a different time. But it's a, you know, it's a long-term plan. It's not a, we've got the land, now it's going to appear. It's a very long process of getting the land created and our utilities put in and slowly developing off.
So they'll put infrastructure in as they go? Is that game
plan? I think there's a plan for it per year, but it's just not, I don't know the timeline exactly how quick it's going to go. Of course, it would matter to see if they land a big project tomorrow.
Yeah.
And they need certain requirements. I'm sure they would be probably expedite the process, but again, that's just me assuming from ED standpoint. There's a request in your packet for training for the Parkland Economic Development course. It's offered through the University of, I think it's UNI, University of Northern Iowa. I talked to Nick Boschheim at Lakita McKeon about this, and he had heard of this course, and one of the Lakita McKeon members had attended and had found it to be beneficial. This came my way through just a marketing flyer that emailed to different ED professionals and took a look at some of the courses that they offer, or at the course schedule, and I found the topics to be beneficial to my development that can help me better serve the city of Hartford. Course topics include workforce development, strategic planning, marketing your community, rural development, professionalism and ethics. I'm not really worried about that, but it's important to have the refresher, especially in this position. And real estate and reuse. Real estate, really, something I need to work on.
So with our Lakita PETA membership, we are not considered a partner with this.
We are considered a partner because we are in South Dakota. I've been looking at it a little bit, and since we are part of, since we are within GOED or within South Dakota, we are considered a partner.
That's what I understood when I looked at the registration.
So that would be for 885, if registered before March 17th. And I would recommend, if you do approve this training, recommend to register immediately, because it is only open to the first 85.
I make a motion to approve Jesse for the Heartland Economic Development course under the Partner Association membership of $885 on the dates April 23 to 27.
Second.
And one comment, so we'll be applying for a grant from either Sioux Valley Energy or Fed American.
Good job.
Jesse, do you know how far it is to Blue Springs, Missouri?
It's Kansas City.
Kansas City.
So what, 5.5 hours?
307.
Riverside, KC.
307 would pay state rate on mileage, right? 42
cents a mile.
So roughly $140 one way.
Unless it takes a city vehicle. We can go crazy for it.
Craig would love that, I'm sure.
We'll find you something to do.
A little five-speed.
Here's my only concern, and this isn't a reflection on you. With mileage and the cost of this course, you're going to have 4 days of course, 2 days of travel. Mm-hmm. And then magically something better comes along and you walk out the door after we dump about $1,300 into this. I would be incredibly upset. So my only concern, if we do vote to send Jesse to this course, is if there's something that could be done that says if he doesn't stick around for a year, he can reimburse us for this course. Because this isn't like sending Craig to Rapid City, and this isn't like sending Audra to Sioux Falls. This is sending the new economic development director to Kansas City for a week.
So it would be better at his job. I think it's a good training.
No, I agree that it would be better for his job. I just don't want to pay for the training and then he uses it somewhere else next year.
Amend the motion, I'll second it.
But I don't know how the verbiage is.
You know, I would caution us to start heading down a road like that, though, because I think as the employer, it's our responsibility to do some part of the training. So,
true.
Not doing the training, I believe, leaves a worse taste than offering training to a new employee.
Blind faith.
Why? At some point, you gotta.
You either hire or you don't.
Right.
We need to provide them this training opportunity. And like Jesse pointed out, there are Sioux Valley and Mid-America both offer scholarships to reimburse the expense of this course, and we'll apply to both of them, and so hopefully we'll get at least registration paid for on that portion of it.
I feel like somebody did that to the city. Am I wrong to think that?
I don't remember.
I guess my feelings overall are not in that scenario. I mean, I'm not worried about Jesse leaving. I mean, that can happen with anybody, you know, at any point in time. We've even seen it happen on this side of the table. So, that being said.
All right, Jesse, I'm going to trust you.
Well, you can also sign some sort of.
Well,
no, I'm going to trust you. No. Jeremy brings up a good point.
Right.
I mean, we hired you, we're going to train you.
Some point in time, you gotta get a jump.
Yeah, and I'm looking to profit off of the training. I mean, I think it would be beneficial because, and you hired me at a discount because I have zero experience.
Oh boy. Now you see why it's just exciting right there.
Yes,
a discount. That's why I said
that. Realistically speaking.
No, I don't have a problem with that. I think the training is great.
Yeah. And I'm just really coming from you guys as an employer that is, you know, it's not just $8.85. It's the hourly wage you pay me to sit in those conferences. It's also the per diem you'll pay me to sit through that conference. And it's also the,
Well, I wasn't talking about that.
So, I mean, the price might say $8.85, but it's going to cost more than that.
Right.
Yep, so.
Trust me, the per diem is nothing.
McDonald's is all I need. Not a bacon guy.
All right. Well, we'll call the vote. We got a motion and a second to approve.
That's right, yeah.
So.
I wanted to figure out how to.
With that, we'll go down the table. Nelson.
Yes.
Warren.
Yes.
Franklin.
Yes.
Jones.
Yes.
And I am.
All right.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
I appreciate your faith in me and your trust. I do understand that.
The question I never asked is if Teresa's going to have time to do your job in your absence.
Well, she did it for a while. So I mean,
I know.
But
I
figure it out.
Make sure it's a happy new year. Looking forward to working with you all in the coming year. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks, Joseph.
City engineer report. Mitch.
Yes. I don't have much new to report from the last meeting, but the Mike Franken Trail, we're still waiting for the 404 permit to come through. Plans are in the DOT's hands, so once that comes through, that'll keep moving forward. Mickelson Road, we're going to talk about more tonight, but we do have a meeting scheduled with Sam Asson next Tuesday to talk to him about the project. And then the North Main extension, here I'm going to be following up with the Wintersteins to see if they mold over it. Our last meeting with them and see what they have to say from that. So I'll be following up with them this week, hopefully. And then the wastewater study is ongoing until we get through the Mickelson Road project. And
Mitch, can I interrupt you there for a second?
Sure.
I'm sorry, I had a note from carried over from last year, actually November 15th, and I had written down the February 1st deadline. Are we talking about the same thing when you talk about the South Dakota water plan? That's not related to what we're talking about here, right?
That's the facilities plan, which, yeah, it's the same thing here. Yep.
It is.
Yep.
Okay, so my question is in regards to the February 1st deadline.
Yeah, we'll be making that.
That's all I wanted
to
know. Okay, thank you.
And that's, what that is so that you guys can apply for funding for.
Yeah, that's just to get on the state water plan, so we can apply for funding if we're going to apply for funding.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean we have to work.
Yeah, we'll be ready for that.
Do take notes on the cable.
That's good. on the force account side, let's see. We did follow up with the Crespin and Momas. I see that's on here. I don't know if we heard anything back on that. Did you see anything back to yourself? We didn't see anything back. But we're expecting response back from a lot of those loans in that BFE area, so hopefully those come through here shortly. But other than that, that's kind of all I've got.
Did we ever hear on a night extension?
It's coming. Made a note. No, it did have a report, but I made a note when he was talking about the bike trail.
Yeah.
Just to let you know, I haven't heard anything back. I sent the extension in. I haven't heard that they've approved it or not, but I haven't got a letter asking for the money back either, so that's good too. So I'll follow up with the grant coordinator to see if they've made any progress on that.
That's good. Any questions for Mitch? It's a call to Mickelson Road update later, so we'll talk a little bit more.
What status are we in on the Franken Trail?
We've submitted all our plans to the DOT, and they're waiting on the 404 permit to be able to grade the wetlands and impact those. So we have to wait for a response from the Corps to be able to do that work. And so they're waiting for that application to come back from them, that permit.
Do you remember what year we started this project?
It's been 3 years?
3 years.
It's been like 4 years, going on 4 years.
If we could get this built before I'm not here, would be great.
I agree. It's in their hands, and so we just got to go through their.
Honestly, do you think we're going to let for bid this spring?
Yeah.
Are they going to be able to let for bid and build it next year?
Yes.
If we let it for bid in the spring?
Every indication they've given us.
Yeah, every indication is that we'll get it built.
So that's 50-50 at best.
Every indication. I think they're going
with that. That's half empty with him, isn't it?
But yeah, he's hoping to let it for bid this spring and then construct it in the summer of this year.
Do you know anybody you can call? Larry? Marcy? You know anybody out in Pier you can call and get this?
Sure.
Call them. Don't charge the city for the call either, just call them. Okay? Appreciate it. Then if it gets left for bid and built next year, I'll say Larry Nelson made the call.
Took care.
Jeez. It's been so long. Yeah, it's been a long time.
Alright. Learn that. Thank you, Mitch.
Yep.
Craig for the public works report.
Just a few little items here for streets. When you get the payloader back, both some bearings knocked out on the front end of it and the seals. And I haven't seen the bill yet, but I think we're on probably $5 to $6 somewhere in that area. Well, as the rest of the equipment's all running good right now, we did get the Christmas decorations down. We do have a few potholes that we're going to be addressing, and then also we're trying to figure out something to do with these manholes, the way the streets have heaved up and they're leaving them down like that. So we're looking into something to do with that to take care of them. But at least take some of that sharp pump out of them. Water and sewer, we'll be finished up the DMRs this week, getting those sent off, and we'll finish up all year and paperwork for EPA and DNR, getting that taken care of. We did get the dialer switched over last week. We did some tests on it. We did a power failure and also a high wet well test on them, and they all worked fine, so we got them done and out, and then got the other one sent off today to get rebuilt, and then we'll get that back in about 3 to 4 weeks. We'll switch that out and get rid of the marlin that we've got. So otherwise, park and pool, nothing really new there. We haven't had a chance to haul any dirt yet. It'll probably be now or next spring before we start as hard as it everything's froze right now. So that's all I've got. Somebody's got something for me.
I'm curious, when you say the bearings were knocked out of the front differential, would it be safe to say that the bearings in the rear end are knocked out as well?
We had a discussion with them on that. At this point, we assume they're okay. We did have the grease dropped in it and checked. I'm hoping that in maybe a few years, and maybe of the goodness for you guys' hearts next year, we'll be getting rid of it.
Really?
We'll see a budget on all that.
That's on your list?
That's on my list for next year's budget. Yeah. So.
Just got the back trailer, now he wants a new payload.
He's giving you a lot of notice to think about.
Yeah, still think about the first Santa Claus. Santa Claus in October.
Nope.
Jeez.
I did talk to Craig briefly. Mickelson Road was really iced with all that rain. I don't know if any of you guys drove down there. But I called Teresa and she had Craig run down there that day with the payloader and assault truck and try to clean it out. But boy, we're going to have to really take a look at that. It's a mess where that...
comes through that
drainage.
Yes.
Yeah,
that's
right where that drainage comes through.
Yeah. So...
yeah, we'll be looking, maybe get a hold of the landowner and the farmer up there and see if they can't...
I don't know what... Yeah. It just boils over the sidewalk when it was all that rain.
Yeah. Even with rain.
Man, it was a mess.
Sounds like dust.
Well, this is on the paved part.
This is on the paved part.
Well, that's on the paved part.
Yeah, this is down just past the stop sign.
About a 40 stop.
Just about a quarter, half a block down from Fighter. So.
How's the dust further east? Not bad.
Fair.
All right. Anything else for Craig? Thanks, Craig. All right. Move over to Audra for the finance report.
Okay. In my report, I just highlighted some of the revenue that we received in December, and then in the box has all the cash balances and revenue and expenses through the end of November. I also provided a calendar of events, and we also need to set the 2017 election date. We have it usually on the second Tuesday in April, so that would be April 11th, 2017.
Motion for that?
Yep.
Make a motion to set the municipal election date as April 11th, 2017.
Second.
Discussion? Monahan?
Yeah.
Jones?
Yes.
Yes.
Porter?
Yes.
And Nelson?
Yes.
Thanks. Otherwise, are there any questions?
Okay, just a couple quick updates. With planning and zoning, we will have three new board members coming on next week. We will get them orientated on having them come to the office and kind of giving them just a little briefing on planning and zoning, what they need to look at and what their duties will be. But this year, I plan to have the P&Z board look at, Paul alluded to it a little bit, joint jurisdiction, kind of what it is, what it takes to get jurisdiction, what it means for the city. Have them review it, see if it's something that we possibly want to move forward with, and have a recommendation come to the city council in the next month or so with that. I'll also have them, we'd like to review our comprehensive plan. The last time we updated was in 2011, so, you know, we'd like to try and kind of keep things every 5 to 6 years of updates. So I'd like them to at least review our comp plan, see if any updates need to be made to that. If we do pursue joint jurisdiction, we definitely will have to update our comp plan. So it's a good time to do it. They kind of go hand in hand. Also look at updating our subdivision regulations. We did our zoning regulations last year. Like, take a look at our subdivision regulations, see if anything needs to be amended or changed in there. And then we also talked about this coming year, kind of review our fee schedule for building permits. We haven't done that in quite a while, basically. Just like to go with city administrator, you know, what we charge for a shed, what we charge for a raise for housing, just to review them every so often is probably a good thing. So those are kind of some of the things I plan to have the P&Z board work on this coming year. Next item, I looked, Brennan asked me to look into this a little bit of what it would take to get a color copier for the office here. We just right now just have a black and white copier, as you can tell with your packets, and sometimes we get stuff in color that doesn't come out real clear. So I just started with our current copiers through A&B Business. So I just started with them, seeing if we could possibly retrofit, you know, the copier we got or put an attachment on it, see if, you know, we can make that a color copier. And of course we can't. So, you know, gotta buy a new copier, they said. That copier that we have, we bought in 2011 for $3,500. I had to kind of price it two ways of what it would be if the city would buy a copier, trade in our old one, buy a copier, what that cost would be, plus what the maintenance would be, and give me a total on that, and then what it would be to rent a copier for, which would include all the maintenance. And all their maintenance agreements go out for 63 months, so that's a little over 5 years. So I kind of priced it down for you. Versus whether we buy it or rent it, it's going to be around $10,000 for a new color copier to add to it. So now this is just one company. I can look for more quotes if the council wants me to pursue this further. Currently, we have two inkjet printers to do color copies. I have one in my office and Jesse has one in his. So, I mean, we can make color copies if need be. I mean, it would be nice if the printer did that. I'm sure it would be done at a cheaper cost than what our inkjets are, because, you know, it's kind of expensive to do them on inkjets. When we go to paperless packets, hopefully this year, we can scan in color with the copier that we got now. So, I mean, at least packets could come out in color. So, I mean, you know, it wouldn't be quite the dilemma or the problem, you know, once we go to scanning. So, just wondering if this is something you want me to look into some more, or not what your thoughts
on.
We've
had this one since 2011.
Yeah, 2011.
Okay. How is it otherwise?
Otherwise, I mean, it does pretty good. We were coming for as many copies as we make, and with all the packets we go through, it actually
keeps up
pretty good. And we don't have I mean, you have paper jams here and there and come out and look at it, but I mean, all in all, we haven't had any major breakdowns in it, but it is getting older, you know, it's...
Are we on a maintenance program now?
Yep, we have had maintenance.
So what's our current maintenance cost?
I don't look at that figure, sorry.
I'm sure it's comparable.
I'm sure it's comparable, this would be what our new maintenance plan, but it's probably very comparable.
Does that maintenance plan just go, being we're at 5 years, just over 5 years now coming into that, does that just go month by month or year by year after this? Or do you think there's a longer maintenance
right now? We're in a month by month now.
Month by month now, yeah.
If you take away the packets, all of them, P and Z and ours, do you need a color copy, copier?
If we just go to scan, like I said, we can scan in color, so, I mean, that would definitely, we really wouldn't need the color. And with the inkjets, if there's something we do need in color, we probably could get by, because we wouldn't need that many, you know, there wouldn't be that much we'd be copying that we need in color, so I mean.
So we put it in budget to do paperless for us, right. but it makes sense to do paperless for P&Z as well, and get rid of the, you know, not do a kind of copier for it.
And the P&Zs are the ones that have a lot more maps
more
and
detail.
The building plans and drawings and that, so I mean, it would make good sense to put them paperless too. Yeah.
You mentioned A and B.
So maybe we want to invest in we. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I mean, what's your game plan? Are you solely looking at A&B? Are we going to kind of put this up for bids, or?
I say, we don't need to go out for bids because it's not $50,000.
Yeah, you're right, yeah.
Well, we could look at more quotes, different quotes from other companies, yeah. I mean, I just looked at this one just to give us an idea of what it would cost generally. I mean, I'm sure we can get, the cost will vary a little bit here and there, but I mean, probably
my employer invested in a color copier that doesn't, everything from scanning to the whole thing, and it was about $3,000 less than that. So, you know, I'd like to at least, you know, look outside the box.
Yeah. Oh, no, I don't plan if we were actually going to pursue it. I just wanted to give you a general idea of what costs we're looking at.
Okay, that's good.
My opinion would be, if we're going to go paperless for the council as a trial run, that we do that and we hold off on the printer, and then if, you know, we can address paperless for planning and zoning this October at this time, and if they make the move to that, then really a color copier is going to be, I mean, what are you going to need? What are you going to need a color copier for? In the event this printer just lays down and dies, then I think you look at a color copier.
Oh, yeah.
But I mean, as long as this one's working, and the goal eventually is to get away from paper, you know what I mean? We're talking about getting a color copier when all the conversation's getting away from paper.
Right.
We should have got a color copier when we got this one 5 years ago. So.
Yeah, maybe if we're looking at this money, maybe we want to invest in more. Tablets or laptops versus...
Well, I think when this one breaks so bad that A&B says it's not worth fixing, that's when you look at a color copy. But just to get color for maps and packets, at the same time you're looking at going paperless for the council, and then possibly planning going the following year, it just seems like I'd rather invest that money in.
And I like the idea that we have the ability to make some of those color copies on a small basis. You know, if you needed to from your office or from Jesse's office, you can. If we've got landowners or, just people that we need to.
Mm-hmm.
And for this price, I would imagine we could go, tablets. If we decide that we get our tablets in March, we say, this is going great, let's get P&Z theirs sooner, we can dip into that fund a little quicker.
What were they, Trace? Like 800 or 900 bucks for tablets? Or
each?
Yeah.
I don't think they were even that much.
Sure. About 4 to 5.
I would say about 400, probably four something, yeah.
Just
that was the deluxe one. I mean,
just out of curiosity.
Yeah, below us for three.
On an average, how much time do you spend in a given week putting packets together? Would you estimate?
Well, it depends on what's all on the agenda. I mean, I still will have to gather all the information.
Of course.
And you're still going to have one original copy because I got to scan everything.
Yeah,
but once I scan it, then I don't have to
do the copying and everything.
Copying and put all them together and put them in your pack.
Which I think would make up most of your time.
Yeah, so. Hours a week.
Is the current copier network?
No.
It's not.
Yes.
Well.
Yeah.
Or just our email is on it.
Our email, I mean, we can print
it. Can JC and everybody send it to that unit?
Yes.
Okay. And you assume you don't get free ink with that, do you?
Yeah.
Because they're telling me, with the maintenance agreement.
You get free ink with that?
Yeah.
Okay. And as far as the cartridges for the color copiers, you don't get free ink for that?
No, not for the inkjets, the two that we have.
And is the scanner a separate machine?
No.
Okay.
Not for the copier.
All the supplies are included in the service plan.
Yes.
Yeah, that's why I was getting it.
If they break down, they come out, it don't cost them.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, so.
That's what I do.
If I was to really feel warm and fuzzy about this and just want to jump on board, this would come out of general fund?
Yeah, if we buy getting off the supply of the general fund.
For the sake of getting the temperature of everybody else, I'm going to make a motion for Teresa to reach out to a minimum of three companies to price quote a color copier that would be networked, include a maintenance package of 6 to 3 months minimum, and have all the amenities of the current copier scanners in the building. So in other words, make it all in one, okay? So you have one source, one machine, and surplus the rest.
Surplus all the rest? So then, if that
so
breaks down, we have no copier at
surplus,
all?
You can save one. We don't have the surplus the rest.
That
skip,
has happened.
Skip the surplus and save that for later.
Don't leave us without any.
Yeah, but I think that, I know our office runs a lot more efficiently with all-in-one type scenario.
And for, you know, if we have big print jobs, we mainly use the copier. Everything's set to that. That's why we had it networked, because it is a cheaper printing cost.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right.
So we have that motion. Do we have a second?
Yeah, I'll second.
All right. More discussion? Do you have all of it there?
I've got it all.
Okay.
You want it red?
The motion is
no,
the price
no.
Goals for it in summary.
It's 3 cents.
Three companies.
I got it.
Okay. Nelson?
Yes.
Warren?
No.
Roman?
Yes.
Jones?
No.
Montana?
No.
Okay. Motion fails.
I'd like the motion that we table this conversation until after the council has paperless packets.
I'd second that.
Discussion? Okay. Montana?
Yeah.
Jones?
Yes.
Kerneman?
No.
Warren?
Yes.
And Nelson?
I'm going to say no.
Well, that's okay, because we're still in the report section.
Well,
that motion failed.
Yeah.
That motion failed. That old motion's failed.
I move and move on.
Move on.
So.
That's not debatable, isn't it, Larry?
Okay, moving on. Just want to let you know, the 5 acres by Central States, about a month ago, the council had a discussion about what city land we're going to keep for our own use, what we would offer up for sale. And 5 acres north of town that we have, the council talked about putting a selling price on that at 2.5 a square foot. As you recall, a few months ago, we had an offer on that land, and they asked the council to come up with a counter offer on it. And we told them when we get a price on that land, we would let them know. So before I am going to go solicit bids to farm it, I did contact the gentleman that gave us the offer to see if he'd be interested at the 2.5 square foot. He's going to talk with the other party that's partnering with them and get back to me and let me know yes or no. So once I hear back from him, then we can move forward or not. But I haven't heard anything yet. I did contact him, and they're thinking about it, and they said they'd let me know within a week or two. So
what was it they offered us again?
They offered us like
11 something.
I think it was
5,000.
Was it 5,000? Yeah, an acre. It was quite a difference though. What we're offering now.
Yep.
So yeah.
Just more.
Right.
Give or take.
Yeah.
Got it. Give or take the payloader and the printer.
Yeah.
They can hurt about it.
So once I hear from him, I will let the council know, and we can move forward with that. CCOG, I told you I'd like to have them work on putting our municipal ordinances together all into one, so we have one document to work off again. They are doing that, and once they get that put together, I'll review it and bring it to the city council for review. And I would like to ask the council if I could look at possibly updating our employee manual or get some information to update it. As you all know, Audra is expecting, and we don't have anything in our employee manual that addresses maternity leave. So if it's okay with the council, I'd just like to contact other municipalities, see what they have in place, see if it's something we want to entertain or not. So
I'll make the motion that Teresa research with surrounding communities to include Sioux Falls and maternity / paternity leave.
Yep. Second.
Set.
Third.
Had it. Nelson got
it. He's too quick.
Okay.
That's good. That's good. Any more discussion on that?
I can also, my wife's in HR, so I can also send you some stuff from her as well if you like.
Sure.
Has this never been a question before?
No, I haven't had anybody have that problem since I've been here
so long.
Problem?
Problem? Jesse.
No, we have.
We almost third child.
Jesse's going to have third child since. Because I've been here.
It's part of it. All right.
Yep. All right, we got a motion and a second. We'll go. Corn.
Yes.
Nelson.
Yes.
Jones.
Yes.
Monahan.
Yes.
Cronin.
Yes.
Okay, and that's all I have for updates.
Thanks, Teresa.
Congrats again, Audra.
Yes, congratulations. All right, with that, we'll move on to old business. And first thing up is some road updates.
Just to give you a little update from my end, and then I'll let Mitch kind of go into it. We haven't set up a meeting yet with Sam Mass or Jacob, some of the other parties that we want to talk with about acquiring land. They were gone over the Christmas holiday. We do have, this week, we just today got a meeting set up with Sam Mass for the 10th, so we'll be meeting with him before our next meeting. So hopefully we'll have some more information to update you with them. We'll keep trying to get a hold of Jacob tomorrow, let you know where we're standing there. So Mitch does have some cost estimates for you on the road and the different sections of it that he'd like to go through with you.
I handed out a couple things there that are going on. One is just updated cost estimates based on our conversation from the last meeting. Simply just broken down a little further. Based on kind of the phasing that we talked about at that meeting. And then also there's a sheet for kind of help explain the assessment policy. I thought it would probably help explain soon. So just to start off with the cost estimates, we've broken them into three phases here. First phase being from Patrick to the gravel road. That road that we're looking at that goes north up the railroad. That's the third phase, and actually the second phase is from this gravel road out to the highway 38. Okay. It's kind of hard to see on the handouts, but the utilities are showing up in there. All the improvements are pretty much laid out. You get a good idea of what all those costs are going to be. When you go to the next few pages, you can see each phase individually with a further breakdown of the cost in regards to water, sewer, street, sanitary sewer. just to talk about each one a little bit here. So with phase one, you can see that we're at about $1.9 million. We are proposing to extend sewer through this area to help serve the adjacent properties. We have to extend water main from where it's left off at Shamrock through that stretch. We also have storm sewer within the street, extending up to Shamrock to serve that area. So that's basically an overview of the infrastructure. We're also planning what would be a temporary lift station. To be able to put the sewer in and service this area, we would need a temporary lift station if we just did this project on its own the way it stands. Okay. Now, if we decided to do the whole project all the way to highway, this wouldn't even happen. We would push it down further stream, okay, more into the Sam Assens land. And that's kind of what's showing up on the second page. Okay, so on see the second page, right now we're estimating that at just over $3 million. Again, we have, you know, sewer and water and storm sewer running throughout that entire street section. This is an oversized street, so it's a 41-foot street, which is basically the same size as what it is to the west of Patrick. It's an asphalt street. Here, once we get past into this radius, and we've talked about it, needing to acquire this land to make this happen. We are also proposing putting in a sidewalk, the widened sidewalk at this stage. We're not proposing doing a widened sidewalk to the west of there because we're not, you know, that landowner is not willing to give up that right of way, so we won't have that room to be able to put that widened sidewalk in. That's why it's not showing up on anything on the west of there. Okay. Part of this project, you know, we would have the box culverts that would have to go in. We're estimating those at about $500,000. That's really a placeholder. That could be a bridge. Once we get to a span of about 35 feet, we have to look at whether a bridge would be more economic or whether box culverts would be. So if we get into final design on this project, that's what we would be evaluating there. Okay, and then up in the corner here where we're kind of meeting 38, there's a lift station that would be proposed at $200,000 for to construct that. Are there questions on those two phases?
We, if I remember choosing those correctly, we have still not heard back from as far as the correspondence in regards. So can that ask him, so that directly affects this page?
Yeah. Right? We're meeting with Sam on Tuesday to talk about this project. Yep. And what we'll be talking about is what's he willing to contribute towards this project to help with this, because this benefits his property greatly there. Sorry.
It's okay. You're close to me, I can hear
so you. We'll be talking to him about what he's willing to contribute to this project. Our goal, you know, part of this discussion tonight is talking about the assessment policy. We'd kind of like to know going into there a little bit where you guys are at as far as, you know, do we want to ask him to pay for, you know, the entire roadway? In the past we've done where the city, you know, they'll pay for the standard size of street, or I'm sorry, the developer pays for a standard size of street, then you would pay for the oversizing cost. You know, on this particular roadway, you know, maybe we should flip to the assessment policy sheet. What I did here is I simply took a standard roadway. This is your minimum standard for a residential street, which is 37 foot back to back. Okay, and you can see the numbers kind of for each color band here, below here. So for a residential street, on a per foot basis, you have these numbers. So when you total it across, you got $212 a foot. Okay, now if you divide that in half, and each person on each side pays their fair share, they're paying half of that cost. Okay, so that roughly is about $100 a foot for that type of street. Now when you go to a road like Mickelson Road, that's 41 foot wide. Well, that totals about $280 a foot. So we're at $140 on each side. Okay. So I guess to me, our goal at the minimum should be to surely get in to pay for a residential street, if not the full 41-foot street. And it's kind of your guys' decision how you want to approach that. That being said, there's also other landowners on here. We have a delayed assessment against properties that aren't annexed in. We have several other properties that are also annexed in. I would assume we would approach them the same way. There's costs of the lift stations. Our goal would be to get him to pay for all the lift stations and spread it out to the benefiting properties. So I don't know what you guys' thoughts are in that regard, or if you have any input that you want to share.
How many, do you know how many feet Aspen would have, Mitch?
Yeah, I wrote it down over there.
Because he obviously has more on the north side, but less.
2850?
Yep. 2850.
That's both sides?
Yep, that's both sides. That'd be his frontage. So that'd be
2850 is the frontage?
Yep. So he has 1200 basically on the south side and 1640 on the north side.
What's that add up to, Mark?
$399. Would you suggest are both those lift stations going to benefit him, or just the one?
We just have one.
We'd only have one up with the two.
If we did both phase one and phase two, we wouldn't do the one up by Jardine's property. We would not do that one, and only do the one and bring that off to the east. Yeah.
So his footage in that lift station would be $599,000. Did I get that right?
Well, okay.
This is just street cost, right?
Right, that's just street
cost. This is just street cost. This isn't the sanitary sewer or the water.
Yeah, if you notice on the side there's these list of items. And traditionally, when you've done other projects, I mean, you tend to, this is just a street cost, so it's just asphalt, curb and gutter, the gravel that's underneath it, the fabric that goes underneath the street section. It doesn't include all these things that are listed on the side. So, there's incidental costs for mobilizing equipment and erosion control, removals, traffic control.
Yeah, but I mean, would we be looking at asking him to cost share the water and the sewer and the...
Yep.
We can assess that now, yeah. So.
But that's what I asked you to talk to Larry about. Because, I mean, if we assess Sam that on that project, we have to assess everybody that on that project.
If we do a per linear foot, it probably have to be set at the same rate for everybody along there. Yeah. So you can assess it as a per foot basis. And the only other way to assess as a benefit basis, but then you'd have to figure out a formula of how to
do it. So how would you get around it by doing separate projects?
If you want to assess one landowner a different rate than the other landowner, probably. So say you do like phase one and you want to set an assessment rate at that, you can set it at that. And then phase two, if that's going to be a separate project, you could set a different rate for that if you want. I mean, every project.
Because
if you start assessing water and sewer and all that other,
Here's the one thing: the street and the water are easier probably to assess in a way because they're on a linear basis. The sewer benefits an area more than just, and then you can put. It's easier to put that on an area basis than it is on a linear foot basis. So with the sewer, we haven't gotten to that yet. We need to break down the basins. We'll be working on that this week. But breaking down what properties in that area benefit, taking all those sewer costs and rolling it into a cost per acre. So we just say it benefits X amount of acres, and we got so many, whatever cost that was for the sewer in that project, we would say, well, that sewer assessment is this much per acre.
and here's the district that that will apply to, okay?
So that's what you guys are gonna have to figure out.
Yeah.
Because the guy that lives, the guy that bought Roland's place, I mean, he's not coming in, we're gonna have to eat that.
That'd be a delay assessment.
We'd delay it.
Well, you're gonna eat it until, for how, who knows how.
I figured with, you know, we had $75,000 in escrow right now from what Kelly Point has contributed so far. You know, with all the land that is annexed, I think I came up with about $465,000 in street, if we set it at $100 a foot, okay? And then there was about another $200,000, about $134,000 in water main that could be assessed. So we're looking at roughly around $800,000 is what you would have today coming back pretty quickly by direct assessment or whatever's in escrow already.
For which phase?
For phase one and two.
For phase one and two?
Yeah, total together. And then I think there was about $600,000, if I remember right, of delayed assessment for a street and water.
Mitch, you're talking about $800,000 on a $5 billion project. I don't know. I'm still in the situation. I'm on board for phase one, but I think phase two conversation solely depends on Mr. Aspen.
Yeah. See, and I agree with you. And I think that the nice thing is, it is nice to have this broken out this way because you can look at it and say you can open up development ground if that seller is willing to sell to the north of phase one.
Right. And I want to take it one more step for you guys, because right now you can't see the assessments and who's going to get an assessment. We didn't have time in the last 2 weeks to get all that together, but that'll be another key point for you guys to see. So then you can see that sewer district and see what it is per acre, what the sewer the assessment would be on an acre basis, and also the street assessments per property. So you can see that.
On the main line, on Mickelson, on phase one, the developers put it under the lots, they pay for all that, right?
Yes.
So when they put a road in, they pay for the sewer under the road too?
Yes.
Okay, so we're typically responsible for the main lines.
For the arterial roads, yes, you have been.
Yep.
Like when you did Nicholson to the west, Patrick, you guys fronted that project. There was an assessment on it, but it was at $50 a foot. And that project cost more than that, obviously. There's probably no lines of that $100 a foot back then.
How much did you say that bridge or box cover would be? $500,000?
That's what we
that's
got.
That's a substantial cost. Back, just to go back a little bit in history, not that you want to, but back a long time ago when we did your street reconstruction projects, we actually went through a process where we actually had, like what Teresa was talking about, where one project would cost X, and so we had assessed that frontage and those costs to those people for the street. Well, then the next project would cost Y, and that would be different costs. That might be more, might be less. And so that's where we run into problems back in the day with, we'd have one project that was expensive, the next project might be less cost, and so then the people the year before wonder, hey, why did ours cost more than theirs? And it had to do with where they were at or whatever. The project might have been a little smaller, so the cost per foot got a little bit larger. And so that's why you went to a flat rate cost per foot of assessing people X amount of dollars per front foot, and then you adjusted it every 4 to 5 years as you felt those rates should be going up, so that you're not covering all those costs, and the you know the abutting properties are paying for their proportionate share. But that allowed you to fix that assessed cost per front foot, and that way it took a lot of risk away from the developer, if you will, and kind of put it on you.
Is this phase two, is this even taken into account delineating wetlands?
Yeah. Yeah, we had a...
I don't see that number. Did I see that number?
67,000.
Wetlands we got, yeah, 67,000 is what we got budgeted in now.
That seems low.
We used...
For those wetlands.
No, we simply what we did there is we looked at what the impact was on Mike Franken Trail, and that came to be about $17,000 an acre over there. We used $20,000, and we bumped it up a little bit from that. So we looked at what we felt we would impact the wetlands here, and that's how we got to that budget number.
So you think there's only 3 acres that are affected in there?
As of right now, yeah.
Does this $3 million include the box culverts then?
Yeah.
Okay. Is that under the storm damage or storm drainage?
Yeah. And right now we're thinking, you know, if you go down to Fighter, there's 4 box culverts there. We're probably going to have to go to 5 in this area because it's further downstream. And that's where, once we get to that size, we need to start looking at the bridge as a bridge as a possibility.
Okay.
And if you know, you know, we didn't talk about the third phase here, but there's a box culvert underneath that one. That's why that project gets kind of expensive too on the drainage side. So there's another, I think about $275,000 for that one.
We're still on Mickelson, right? We're not on the assessment policy.
Right.
But, okay.
Here's a crazy idea. Instead of doing 3 projects, with a combined total of 6 box culverts, why don't we look at scratching, hooking on to 38 straight north of Sam's, and just put in phase 3 and pull all that traffic into his development on one road that has 1 box culvert? Why do we have to cross that creek twice?
Right. I mean, you don't have to do any of these projects. I mean...
But you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
For over $5 million, why are we even entertaining the thought of crossing there for convenience? Why don't we just put in phase 3? Why don't we just do phase 1 and phase 3 and run that stub to his property, run it right to his front door and say, there you go.
Well,
I agree with you.
All right, time to go home.
I mean, obviously, if you get that connection, that would help with traffic flow. You know, but it's still important to have this connection off to the highway. And whether that winds through Sam's property and comes up further east, we can talk to him about that. But at some point, we feel that this still is an important connection to maintain out to the Highway 30.
Well, just out of curiosity, if we just do a small portion of phase 2, just to get it to his northwest corner, 20 years from now, when that thing's full, somebody else can worry about crossing the creek and having it squirt out on the east side. You'll be an old man. I'll be gone.
I see, you know, and I see what you're saying there, Mark. Yeah. I also think that if he were going to get DOT approval, which I don't, you know, we would want to have some control over how we're going to connect to 38. I don't know if he would be able to do all of those things, but if I'm living in a house down here, way in the bottom corner of this sheet, I ain't buying that frickin' house. If I got to drive up here, over here, up to the school, then over to 38, and drive through probably 3 different type of residential neighborhoods just to get on a main road.
Right. I mean, I don't think you give up on this connection. I mean, you don't have to do this today.
I'm not saying give up on it now. Yeah. I'm just saying do 1 box culvert to get it started. Let somebody else worry about the bridge later.
Right. Yeah.
I think ultimately we're talking in circles until we talk to Sam.
It is.
Yep.
And that's
until we have that update. We can't do anything.
Really, it lessens it as the word we keep using, arterial road, if you don't have this connection.
Right.
In my opinion, Now, I'm going to say, living on Nicholson, I like your idea, because it sure as heck's going to stop the traffic or slow the traffic down coming past my house. I'm telling you. Because if this thing runs out to 38...
You know how fast they're going to go?
No, I understand how fast they're going to go. I know how fast they go right now past my house.
Well, yeah. We still have to maintain access to these properties, too. I mean, you can't just vacate that road and just get rid of it. You know, we do have to maintain access to it. We have a bridge, you know, that probably needs some repair sooner or later. You know, we keep...
A couple more blocks.
So, I mean...
I think ultimately, this is a good. I agree, this is a good build-out plan with the road, with the crossing and whatnot. It'll serve the community really well long-term. I don't disagree. I mean, this is. I mean, when you look at that bridge cost, or the box, whatever we end up building there, that's a big cost to try to get something going to get down there. You know, maybe you. You back up and really even just think about what it would it take to just get utilities down there, so that it's, that Sam can get started, so that he's at least got utility access.
That'll be one. That's one conversation we're gonna have with him, because he's got access. You know, it's a gravel road. I mean, how bad does he want a street? You know, that's probably the question we have. Is, are you willing to pay for that? But in my mind, for him to get started, he needs really a water meter, probably about it. You know, that's probably the only thing he doesn't have is water. And then from there, he'll do, take care of the sewer and do a force main to a lift station.
That's where we started with this, was having him do his own thing. And, you know, come back to, the reason it come back was because it isn't just his. I mean, it's other people are going to benefit from that lift station and that sewer line. And that's where the city usually comes in, and you kind of create and build the drainage basin, and then you do the cost recovery, which unfortunately then you front those costs and then try to get paid back over time.
Well, I'm all for having the conversation about getting him services so he can get started going, but I mean, we got sidetracked, you know, which I thought was going to be a $3.3 million project. That's, every time I look at this, we're knocking on the door $6 million now. Mm-hmm. So I kind of forgot about the water service. You know, because we just started talking about $6 million worth of roads and bridges.
So that's everything, though. That includes the utilities, too, the $6 million.
I know that's turnkey, but that's a lot of money.
Yeah.
So, and really, I just want
to know. And this way you can kind of look at the costs per segment. That's a good way to look at that. And then also, you know, we'll go back and look at, you know, what benefit each party would have, so that we can identify what would those costs per acre be for the sewer costs, you know, what should their cost for water and things like that be also. We just haven't had a chance to put all that together and then talk to Sam and find out where his motivation really is.
That's what I'm curious about. I'm curious where his motivation is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, we've talked about Sam quite a bit. I'd like to turn to Mr. Jarvie and his associate and have you approach the podium and give me your assessment on this assessment.
Please. Hang on a minute. Write that down.
No. The assessment. Give me your assessment on the assessment.
Don't write that down.
That'll be on the Christmas party.
We're already started.
It actually means
sense. Well, that put you on the spot.
Yeah.
Well, as you know, the three phases of Keller Point, that's already been in the bank for a couple of years, that street assessment. So just to get out front, we'd like to see that street get done. Like I said, we had to put that to the blocks. They're within 2 years of that. So, and what you do with Nicholson hinges on what we do with our development.
Yeah. You
know, so, I mean, that's why we're here, just to see what your ideas are.
And what's your have you seen this before?
No.
Okay. Okay. Obviously, phase three is something that affects you also, indirectly, in a way. You know, how important, Mr. Monahan alluded to, you know, making, you know, phase three kind of putting it on the front burner a little bit. How important is that road that you have in front of you to what you have going on in 2017?
Well, the biggest question on our development is that sewer duct. I mean, where is it going? Are we, is it going in our corner or is it going down here?
This was
Yeah,
the question, we had two lift stations on the proposal. One was at this corner. If we only did Mickelson, we'd have to get a lift station here so we could service you guys. And if we proceed forward all the way down to here, that doesn't make sense for a lift station here because the cost of a lift station is about the same as extending the sewer to there. So it didn't make any sense for us to have two lift stations right there. You just run it to the east farther, have one lift station to serve everybody there. And so right now we're looking at, if we only did Mickelson, we'd have to put a lift station in there, and that's why we show one in there. We just show a line item for that. That could actually be a really scaled back lift station if it's just, you know, your few homes that you guys have to put on there. But keep in mind, when we put in, if you scale that way back, a lift station, if you will, those tend to be there for a long time. And unfortunately, we end up maintaining those. So, you know, we would like you to put in a decent lift station that is going to be easily maintained and, you know, evaluated and kept up easily, if you know what I mean.
With that being said, too, I mean, if the sewer is drained to us, I mean, you have the potential on the south side, which to me is ripe for picking it for development as anywhere in this town, you know, on Stumpy's ground.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, so that makes it, like he said, I mean, pretty soon they want to get in there and then that lift station too small.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, you know, when you know, putting it out as a sewer district is probably a good idea. But, you know, it, like John alluded to it, I mean, is this a two-year lift station or is this a forever lift station? You know, and all these questions got to be answered before we can develop. And, you know, that we want to get this done next year, but, I mean, we can't do it without medicine.
Right.
And, you know, as you know, we've talked about swapping lands and everything else, so your assessment, you're probably asking the wrong guy about that.
Okay.
This is my brother Bob, by the way. He's a partner in Kelly Point, too.
So, I mean, honestly, I really get the feeling that we're going to have to find out what Sam wants to do,
mm-hmm.
and then we're going to have to decide if we're literally just going to get sand utilities and do phase one and figure out the lift station.
To me, I agree. There's a lot of moving parts to this, and it's that I think the key is, you know, how motivated is Sam? We obviously know these guys want to get moving forward, so, you know, their desire would be for you to get moving on Mickelson at a minimum, and which would be phase one, or at least the utilities for that, but I'm sure they want all of the street in. Mickelson and the phase three would be their motivation, but
I don't think this council's in a mood to hold these gentlemen up just because we don't have the stomach for a $6 million bond and we don't like the number that Mr. Assen wants to participate in. I don't think that these guys need to pay the price.
That's
just
why
because,
we broke it up into
those two
phases.
Things don't come together.
Right. That's why you can make those decisions now is with a stepped approach, which is a good idea.
I guess if we have to build a lift station twice, then so be it. But
John, how many, if the city were to do phase one and three, do you have a rough idea how many lots that opens up?
15. Yeah. And one thing to keep in mind, too, about phase three, I mean, I brought this up before. The bridge hit that you had a year ago. The next time that goes through, they'll probably take the bridge down. You know, so that's an outlet for the city. It's not just Kelly Pointer.
Right.
You know, that's your way out of town. If that gets, I mean, it's, really, if you look at it, it's a pretty crucial road.
Yeah.
To get another outlet out there.
Yeah.
I think, as a fire chief of Humboldt, and, of the other things, you know, you look at ways you can get in and out of that town.
The other thing is, you know, John mentioned that opens up 15 lots, but it's actually really all of the property to the south will be opened up technically. It's just whether or not you got a willing seller and developer there, if you know what I mean.
Yes.
I mean, it's all of a sudden you went from being, you know, 15 lots to the reality is you got another 80 acres there.
Yeah. I think it's important to remember, you know, what we're finally finishing up Kelly Point with are some pretty premium lots. Mm-hmm. And we're going to compete with Sioux Falls.
Right.
So, I mean, we're going to be asking the price for the lots. They're not going to expect gravel. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, we're going to push Sioux Falls prices with these lots because of the cost of the building, and development. So we got to give them some quality streets. I mean, I'm not, and especially on the south side, you can't sell six-figure lots and have gravel in front of them.
Right, we can't. I mean, unless you put the water main under the gravel street, we can't do the problem. Right? We need water main too. So.
Right. So, you know, our lots won't be six figures, but the south side of that development probably will be by the time it's done. Uh-huh. And now you're competing with Sioux Falls, so.
Have you guys had quite a bit of pushback back in phase two here for not having that paved? I mean, do you hear that when you're selling lots or no?
Just right. Got mowing the ditches.
Yeah, just got mowing the ditches all the time. No, we really, you probably hear more complaints about that. I mean, people ask, when's it going to get done? And I tell them, you know, we divvied the money up, and when they go to the next phase, it'll be done.
Well, my bigger complaint is I've been hearing that it's going to get paved for 10 years.
Well, yeah, I don't know. I mean, that's up to you guys. But like I said, when we plotted that, I mean, we had 2 years to have the money in place for the road, and, you know, I think we started that in 2004, so.
And was 17 when we were expecting to do something? That was in the...
That's what we have in our CIP.
In the CIP. Yes. And how much did we have in the CIP?
I think CIP we had 3.5 maybe?
Yep, 3-something. Yeah. That's about 3. Yeah. Well, I think we're not going to make any decisions tonight, but it gives us a lot more perspective, and I think if we can update the council from their meeting on the 10th. I plan on going along on their meeting on the 10th as well. Maybe Jesus at your office, Tracy will be there.
Yep, me and Craig.
Craig will be there. And so we can update the council on what comes out of that meeting so that next time we get together, we can have a little bit more formidable discussion on how we're going to move forward.
John, in your development, the phase three road, that would open up more lots for you too, correct? For some commercial.
Well, then two, you know, you don't. Yeah, then the back three, the east three face east, so they would be landlocked if we don't do that street.
I mean, and then Hassan's actually has a chunk there too. That
he's got a little chunk.
He was looking at developing that once.
And then, you know, with that in mind, we throw the lift station down there a little ways so Sam can get...
Yeah, we'd have it, sir. It would service anything in that area.
In that area, yeah. So. And Terry mentioned, too, all of Stumpy's wouldn't have to go through the lift station.
Right.
If you look at the elevation...
20, 30 acres could go with your existing
with
sewer.
With the gravity
jammer.
Yeah,
yep.
Thank you, gentlemen.
All
right. I appreciate that.
Alright, so we'll have more information next week.
Thank you, guys.
Alright, so let's move on.
Do you want to talk about this?
So let's go right into these separate thoughts. Yeah, I agree with that.
This is where we started kind of talking about a little bit.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, John.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, you guys.
Thank you.
And just to give you an update, no decisions have to be made on this tonight either, but I put in your packet again what our current assessment policy is. And this is just for streets, curb and gutter. It doesn't, it's no utilities, no water, sewer, or anything. But currently, we're at $80 a linear foot. And that's what we've kind of reviewed this about every year. Last year, we didn't do anything. We were kind of going through a little turmoil, so we just stayed status quo. But, about 3 years ago, we were at $49.50, and we bumped it up to this $80, but and that's where we're sitting at now. Now, this can always be amended, changed. Like I said, we can go project by project here out, but, so nothing needs to be done with this, but this is where we're at when we kind of start thinking about it, especially as we're looking at these projects.
And now, just so I'm clear on it, just to be sure that I'm looking at the right numbers, that $80 per lineal foot covers how much? Is it, it's their half of the road, their curb and gutter.
Asphalt. Curb and gutter, asphalt, sidewalk, gravel underneath, and...
So everything from, yeah, basically that side over everything to the sidewalk.
Yeah.
Okay.
City doesn't pick no sidewalk.
I was going to say.
We have never...
Just the street.
Property owners are responsible.
Property owners are responsible for the sidewalk.
Right, right, but on Nicholson Road, the first half, we built the sidewalks, and it was part of the assessment back then.
So to cover the street, it'd be 106 per foot.
Yep.
For each side.
Yep.
And we'd be getting 80 foot assessed back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But if we want to just cover our costs, we'd get a 106 assessment.
Right. Yes, exactly.
And we went from 49 to 80, how long ago?
I think 3 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. When we first did the change to review it.
But it'll cost us more than just
that. Yeah, because, you know, what's not included, there's intersections, you know, that nobody abuts, so you end up having to pay for those anyway, you know, the utilities and all those things kind of listed on the left side there.
Okay.
Are not part of this.
Gotcha.
$106, $140. I mean, the water and sewer you pay, usually that gets paid through your user fees for water and user fees for sewer and those things.
I'm going to make a motion to change the assessment policy to $100 a foot.
Second.
All right, any discussion?
106.
That's across the board flat rate for everything, right?
You think it's 41 foot?
Just because, Mark, the 106 is a... It's an estimate.
It is an estimate.
Yeah. I mean, you know, the size of the project is going to dictate the mobilization, the discount you get. You know, just like John was saying, a smaller project is going to be more per foot than a... I mean, 106 is just a ballpark, just like 100 is. 100 is just a ballpark on some.
And Mark, on the 41-foot street, the reason why that got... The city's always been in agreement with... developers, Matt, that if we widen the street out on our request, we'll pay for the difference in the width. If we upsize a sewer line or a water main, because they're required, like a development's putting an 8-inch.
But they're giving up their land too, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because they got to have more of a meet right away in there.
That's essentially the trade-off. So.
Yeah, we ask them to build to the minimum standard.
Yeah.
And if we ask them to upsize, then the city is.
This paid it. In the past, that's what we've always done, just because it ain't fair to a... like in a residential up in there, they end up with a wider street in front of their place. It doesn't benefit them at all. It's, you know, they still pay what a normal street would be in that situation.
Okay. What was that number again, Mark?
$100.
And so if I understand this correctly, sometimes I don't.
Rarely.
Yeah, really. Mitch earlier alluded to a 37 and or 33 foot street. Mr. Horn never be able to get a 37 foot street in front of his home. So I have a little problem with him paying more than someone else who's getting a 37 foot street.
If it's something narrower, we have to go with something less than this, then we're probably obligated by it. State laws assess. We can only assess the benefiting improvements. So if we have a street that's less than this for some reason, we would have to lessen it. We can only assess what those improvements are.
How sure. About... So can we add wording for 37 foot?
The way this reads is the assessment rate for any special assessment is not to exceed. So we can always go less.
How about we put in verbiage that says the street assessment shall be $100 per foot or the actual cost for curb, gutter, and asphalt, whichever is less.
I'd be careful with the curb, gutter, and asphalt.
quote, just because somebody might take that literally and just say curb, gutter, and asphalt.
Well, then what's the word, John?
Street improvements.
For street improvements, whichever is less.
Yes. Because that includes your grading, street lights, different things like that, and there's other costs associated with it. To me, you probably need to stick with lighting, street improvements.
Well,
yeah. To your standards.
That to me can get a little fuzzy though too, because we talked about earlier how we just lumped everything into one project. In the past, we've lumped five different streets into one project. So if we do, for example, 4th Street, that small skinny street along with a Nicholson, then my road is, I'm paying for.
But usually the engineers go through and they break it down into what each area is.
They will, okay. Phase 1 and 2 is, yeah.
Is this
cost more to
only for petition?
I feel like if you leave it with the word not to exceed, and just leave it like that. Because
yeah, I think so too. I was just going to go there. I think you brought up good arguments both ways, so I think I agree with Craig that just the not to exceed is good enough. That way you can go down if it did cost less for some reason and you wanted to go down.
It does have not to exceed in it. You're just replacing the 80 with the 100. So if it's a lesser project, you can go with
it. So in the past, what you did bulk all those together is more to get the majority vote than it was to get that.
It's never less. Because, but I mean, really, that ship sailed. Why that policy was put into place all those years ago? Those streets are done.
Are they?
Sure they are.
The only ones that are left are ones that
have problems, or the people just flat out didn't want them, voted against them, whatever.
I understand.
So really, why not just have a policy that assesses actual cost?
I don't even know they need a policy to do that. I think that's just, we can do that just through state law, can't we?
State law says that when it comes to assessment, you can do on a frontage foot basis, and it also says that you can do it based upon benefit, and based upon benefit are all those examples that you have in your attachment. It just doesn't make sense to just do it on a straight running foot basis. State law also says you can set up a special improvement district to deal with things that don't work. And if your engineer suggested one of those things that doesn't work is the way that you set up a sewer system, big pipe at the bottom, get to the top of the hill, they get smaller. Also, the same thing happens with drainage. I think you're always gonna have a special district for that. But it's pretty clear that you have to lay out, regardless of the method that you use, how you got there. And you have a public hearing process where people can come in and say, well, I think you did it wrong, did it right. And ultimately you come up with a plan, and then if they don't challenge and you award the contract, that's the number. But you can come back in and fix assessments or secure all in the bottom of the statute unless you fix it.
Can you do both, or do you have to pick?
I think you can do both.
So we can have a set dollar amount, or?
Let me qualify that. We're doing oranges to oranges. There's an orange on each side of the street. You can't do one method on one side.
No, not
of the street, not the other.
Not what? North to south. I mean, have a $100 per foot policy, or get away from that on a project and just do actual assessment.
I think the policy that we had at one point in time was set up, and John, you were here, and I think I was watching too, but the purpose was to say to people, look, if you get on board and you do these improvements, the city's guaranteeing to you that it's not going to cost you more than X, because the big fear was that the engineer's estimate was going to be $70 and it's going to come in at $150, and oh my God, I'm going to lose my house. So the city said, no,
We'll take care of the cost over.
Yes, that's exactly what we did back then. And what you're saying, I think, Mark, is legitimate too. The reason we were doing that is because we were rebuilding all the streets, and at that time they were all rural sections in town. And we put curb and gutter and new asphalt in, and we tried to get the residents to pay for the curb and gutter and that proportionate part of that. And so in this case, this is more of an arterial street, which can be separate, could be different. You know, you could.
But I'm not even talking specifically about Mickelson. I'm just talking about the future.
Just in general.
And if can you have $100 a foot policy, and if you choose to on a project, whether it's Mickelson or West Fourth or North Vandermark, can you deviate from $100 a foot in the policy and go back to direct cost assessment, while you have that $100 a foot policy in effect? Yeah.
You guys could right now say we're not having this policy anymore. The previous city council was crazy. They didn't know what they were doing. Just because they're stupid doesn't mean that we're going to be stupid. We can't afford to do this. We're not doing it. Right? So you can say we're done with that. And the citizens can come in and say, well, that's not fair. And you can say, well, you should have got on board because you had plenty of opportunity to get that done. So you can just say we're not doing it.
But then you have to rescind the policy.
Right.
Dump the policy.
If you're absolutely correct. If you're having it there, then you got to live by what your policy.
Whatever. So you can't have it both ways.
Well, it's hard.
It's one or the other.
It's hard to do.
Well, let me ask you this: if the policy is at 100, and the 4th Street people petition to do it, well, let's just say it should be at 80. They could come to the council and ask to get the road done at an $80 assessment, and we could say yes or no?
I think you have the right to say yes or no for any variety of different reasons, yeah. But if you're going to say yes and you have a policy...
Okay, let's just say regardless of the cost, if they came and said, we want our road done, everybody's on board for $80 a foot, not $100.
Okay.
Will the council do that? Could we vote on that and go, yeah, $80 sounds good?
I think you could.
So there's your...
Because the policy, right now, the policy just reads up to us.
Not to
you. The policy merely puts a cap on it.
Yeah, that's what the policy puts a cap on it. So
yeah. I'm fine. I think we raised up to 100 as a cap and call it a day.
I agree. Yeah, I'm good with that. Because they have enough. If it's a smaller or a major project.
And then final question, I hope anyway, is that who would be the person that says, hold it, hold the phone, this particular project is not at 100, it's more like 80. Who, is that mentioned?
Yeah, you did most of that.
Did that? Okay, I just want to make sure of that. Okay.
All right, we got a motion and a second. Yep. Call vote. Berman.
Yes.
Jones.
Yes.
Monahan.
Yes.
Nelson.
Yes.
Warren.
Yes.
Okay, so we'll redo this resolution, call this policy, and bring it to you at the next meeting. It's the new number.
Okay.
Thank you for bringing this.
Yeah.
Save a lot of time. And I like your color copies.
They are.
What's this change cost, John?
Was this gifted or was this on Force Count?
You don't get charged.
It was on the
Mickelson Road for copies.
Oh.
You don't get charged for copies.
Yeah, because I didn't want to thank you.
You'll never notice it on the bill.
Well, on that note, I didn't get a copy.
So if I could get a copy, that'd be awesome.
No, you don't get charged for that.
Yeah,
you do in our hourly rates, but not in our...
All right, but I want to say one thing. I appreciate now seeing a breakdown of costs.
Yeah.
Going forward with projects, I'd appreciate seeing that from day one.
Okay.
Just my input.
It takes a... That's great, and we'll do that every chance we can, because it just takes a lot to get to that point, and we get a lot of effort into it to get to that point.
But it, it doesn't go unnoticed because there's a lot of information on it.
Yeah, right there.
Keep these in the papers. So.
Thank you.
You did a good job.
All right, District 3 meeting update.
Okay, just a quick update. I got a chance since our last meeting to meet with the new owners and managers of the events over there. So, new owners of Hartford Restaurant, and then they are also going to be managing the Fireside Event Center there, which is where it will be held. It's Thursday, March 23rd, just to remind you guys again, Thursday night. The social will be at 6 o'clock. One thing I did want to run by you guys. For the social, I plan to have a couple different appetizers there, a meat and cheese tray and a vegetable tray. We will have an open bar. I've been to district meetings, District 3 meetings in the past, where it's just been strictly an open bar and they pay for their own drinks. I've been to ones where you come in the door and you get a drink ticket, but that would be on the city's cost. Wanted your guys' input, just a consensus. Do you want to have the drink tickets or just skip that and just make it strictly an open bar? Just so I give them some direction.
Open bar or cash bar?
Well, cash bar.
Cash bar.
I don't mean open bar. Yeah, we're not going to pay for it. Sorry. Cash bar. Yeah, great. Sorry. I mean cash bar.
Okay.
I mean, we won't be paying for it.
Well,
the thing is, do you want to provide a drink ticket or not and make it strictly on their own? I've been to both. Ways in the past.
I attended one of Del Rapids, and my wife attended that one, and she doesn't drink, and she appreciated that. And I think that one drink ticket would suffice for those who want to go farther than that, they can.
I'm not opposed to that either. I think it helps get the ball rolling for the restaurant, too. I mean, it, for the bar.
We don't want to do one. I mean, we don't want to give them a whole roll of tickets and be responsible for anything.
How many people are we planning on?
They told us to figure for 125 attendees.
See, now, just out of curiosity, the last time I bought drink tickets there, they were non-refundable. So I wonder if you should talk to the new owners and see if we can just be charged. Get a drink ticket when they come in the door and be charged for that ticket, or whether we have to buy the tickets up front and then whether they're returnable or not. Because if we buy 150 drink tickets and we only go through 50, then we're going to have 100 drink tickets to do something with.
Can we just take
a long night?
Can we just take it at the end of the night and find out how many budgets?
And we probably can. I can talk with the new owners and see if they'll just buy whatever drink tickets we use. You know.
See, and I don't like the idea of doling out two or three or four because then if something happens.
We may be responsible. Yeah, I don't recommend just one. And I've only been to where they've just given you one drink ticket.
Right.
And at the end of the night.
See,
that
Larry,
is,
you're doing good.
Larry's laughing because he knows he can get anybody off on one drink.
I'll check into that.
Oh my gosh.
Okay, we'll go down there. The dinner is going to be at 7 o'clock. We'll have a couple of meats, potato, vegetable, rolls, dessert, salad, kind of standard meal there, coffee and punch with it. And then there'll be a program at 8 o'clock, which is Jeremy will probably ask as the mayor to do a short introduction, welcome to Hartford speech, and then the municipal league, the president, will do a short speech, and then usually LeBron at the municipal league kind of gives us an update of the legislative session as what has happened there, because these are, like I said, in March after it's all closed, so she kind of tells what's happened as far as cities, what affects us, what doesn't affect us, and how things went. So the whole thing should probably be done around 10 o'clock, but got a couple ideas I'm thinking about for centerpieces. Maybe we can utilize a business here in town. I've got to do a little more checking into that give those away maybe as door prizes, so kind of looking at something that down that road. So that's my latest update on that. That sounds okay?
Do we need a motion for the drink ticket?
I think we need some more research.
Just want to check into it. So,
do you have any idea what kind of cost? Because we're going to provide the food and all that.
The
Well, no. The municipal league provides the mill, so they're getting the chunk of it.
Okay.
So, that's the mill price. Basically, we'll pay for the two appetizers, the drink tickets, and like any door prizes we want to do, which I'm thinking the centerpiece is to be. I'm thinking it should be less than, it should be around $1,500 for this fee is what I estimated last fall, which I think I'm, yeah, we've already paid that. That was on last year's budget, $500, so we got $1,000 to work with yet, and I think we'll still be under that.
I will make a motion to...
I think we already have motion as far as the amount we could spend from last year when we decided to do this. Is that what you were making this motion for?
Yeah, I was
going to
say, why?
Yep.
Cool. So I think that was allowed to spend up to $2,000 with the
right
motion.
Oh, okay. I thought we were looking at numbers.
We have a number, yes.
No.
I think we were I was allowed to do with $2,000. I think it's only going to be $1,000 to $1,500.
Let her handle it. I don't need to.
I have a budget you've already given me, so.
If the tickets are in the budget, I don't care.
That's why I want to check on cost and, yeah.
That's
so,
just my
I think opinion. I have enough to $2,000 budget to spend on this, so.
All right. That's good. All right, we'll move over to our new billboard lease agreement for the east, the third of the east side billboard number six.
This lease agreement is exactly like the one that came at last meeting that we had for the steakhouse. It was sent out a month ago with that because this is the third of their billboard. It's the other third, and it's leased to Mary Ginn right now. It does have the wording under installation about if there's any cost to the city for removing the advertisement or whatnot, that can go back on the tenant. So that wording is added in there. It's not the new lease that any of the changes lawyer is proposing, but it's the same one we had passed for the steakhouse a month ago. Because this was already sent out a month ago.
Take a motion to approve advertising lease agreement with American.
Second.
All right. This is discussion.
This is the lease that the Speedway subleased to them, correct?
Sublease is up, so they're renewing it all on their own.
And they're going through us then?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep, so this is directly through with between the city and American now. There's
gotcha.
No sublease.
Yeah. Perfect.
Okay. More discussion? Monahan?
Yeah.
Jones?
Yes.
Brenneman?
Yep.
Horn?
Yes.
And Nelson?
Yes.
Okay. Next is to review the proposed changes to the city's billboard lease agreement. For the future.
The changes mirror largely semantic, but some cleanup that we read through, found a word or two missing. Of significance on page one is we wanted to make sure that the use was solely for them going on the property solely for the purpose of the billboard and for no other purpose. On page two, we clarified that if the tax code changed and for any reason there was any taxes due as a result of the tenant's advertising, they would pay that tax. That's under the top paragraph. Under utilities, we made it clear that any utilities installed had to be informed in a manner acceptable to you folks. And then under the installation and removal of it, we added a paragraph that said, if they don't remove their stuff, you guys could, and you could assess that cost against them. When we took down the existing sign, it would have been nice to have the right size boom truck and have some entity that did it full time coming in and doing that. The security deposit addresses Craig's concern on that, and throwing out just for your consideration, should you or should you not say, look, we have a security deposit for $1,000 and says you're going to take your sign down when you're done so we don't get stuck with that cost. Those are really the only changes. Are you happy to explain them or justify them? But the biggest thing is if you want a security deposit, if you leave the sign up.
Yeah. Well, to just verbiage, but then to decide whether we want to collect a security deposit, so. And I think the security deposit can be used for not only if we take it down, but say they don't pay me back rent. I mean, anything that they don't fulfill in this lease, you know, if they owe back rent, we could use that against them.
And the security deposit would be applied to both the east and west facing billboards?
I think we would use, you know, if it's approved this way, we'd use it in all leases going forward, yeah.
But we, is there situations we, this security deposit would have come in handy in the past?
Yeah, we've taken them down and put them, you know, and worked with them before, and we don't have any equipment. I mean, some of the billboards are 40 feet up there or higher.
Okay.
We just want tipped over and lift one to try to.
Really? Okay.
We can get a company in then to do that and be able to pay that with security deposit.
Is that, where do you think, that? Where's the cost if you're hiring that done?
Do
you have a rough idea?
$500, $750, something like that, to get somebody to come in and take them down. I mean, last ones we did, they, you know, they came down fairly easy, but I mean, it's still, they were on the shorter ones, you know, or.
Sure.
You get some of those other ones that get a little steep, so.
Yeah.
So I feel comfortable that the 1,000 should cover it, so.
Okay. Four years ago, when I was marketing chair for the chamber, we did hire a sign company out of Mitchell, and including the vinyl, it cost $1,200 to put that sign up. So, give you an idea.
1,000 should easily cover it. I mean, didn't take them down, so
that
way, like I said, we're covered in case they don't pay lease on it. I mean, if somebody just, if a business went up and fold up, we could be stuck for a month of lease on it that we didn't get paid for. Plus, we have to get the sign down now, and this way, we're, you know, the rental business, and you're secured. We have.
That's relevant. Is that common down the road? I mean, the $1,000 retainer.
I think, like Craig said, anytime you're renting something, usually security deposit is required. So I don't know why this would be anything different. Yeah.
Okay.
All
right. I talked to Patrice about this earlier today. It seems like by the time somebody's at the point where they're not paying us rent or we have to take it down, the cost of collecting that money is going to be more than what you're going to get. You're not going to get it. So,
exactly.
Your security deposit's your only chance.
Okay.
They only give you $1,000. So, looking for a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the new advertising lease space agreement.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Nelson?
Yes.
Brownman?
Yes.
And Monahan?
Yes.
All right. Any questions? Any visitors? Signers? Okay. If not, we'll move on to correspondence. Anything for correspondence? Thank you letters. Anything on that order?
Where did we leave off on the last one?
Hometown Christmas.
Okay. Someone else's turn. I've been. Harden's turn.
Hello, when somebody goes Harden.
You got to be thankful there's somebody Harden, aren't you?
Clean the street up.
Oh yeah, doing your own favors again.
There you go. Hey, I went through the chain of command, kinda, right?
Yeah, he called me up. I called him. Yeah.
I didn't call Craig direct. I called Teresa.
All right. If nothing, we'll move on.
Yeah. I think at this point.
Okay. With that, we've got some work to do in executive session. So I'll look for a motion there.
So moved.
Second.
Aye.
This way you check, guys. How you doing?
Good. Good.
actually working at all?
Yep.
Yep.
Audra's currently at 2150, right, Teresa?
Yep, 2150. Yeah. Yeah, because she got the 50 cents.
You ready? You guys correct me if I get any wrong.
Yeah.
I'm going to move to give the finance officer a 6.5% annual increase.
Seven.
Retroactive to the 1st of January.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
I'm going to make a motion to give the administrative assistant a 3% raise retroactive to the 1st of January.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed?
I'm going to do the development director in two different motions. First off, I'm going to make a motion to give Jesse a 50 cent increase for his 6 month probation period. 50% raise. 50 cent raise.
Second there.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'm going to move that based on that 50 cent increase, that we give him a 6% raise retroactive to January 1st.
Second.
Is that
all
right?
In favor?
No, I don't think
that's all right.
Is that right? One? Hold on. I had 127 written down. What did I miss? I had 2127 written down.
I think we screwed up and gave. We're going to do it all at once. We're just going to do flat 6%.
Yeah, I think that's what we.
Is that where it was?
I think so. Yeah. So we got a motion and a second.
So it's 6% on the 20.
Right. Let's kill this motion first.
I rescind that motion then. Okay. So I move that we give Jesse 6% based on the $20 an hour raise, and that also covers his 6 month.
Yeah, I think that's what we said, right?
That's what we said.
That's about 20, right?
27.
Second.
We already
6%?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed?
Hang on a second. That doesn't look right.
No. I'm trying to figure out what we did here.
2120 is 6% above $20.
Yeah, that's right.
No, it's not 2127, but it's 6% above 20.
So that'd be 2120.
Yep.
Yep, that's right. 6%
on the $20.
6% based on the on the $20.
Yeah, I had 2127 wrote down too, but that's where.
Yeah,
that's right. I don't know where we were at with that.
All right. So that encompasses the 50. That encompasses the 6 months and the annual.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
We straight on that?
Yeah.
That's gonna look really bad on the tape. Public Works. I'm going to make a motion to give Craig Wagner a 7% raise.
Second.
Retro 1-1.
Retro January 1st.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Assistant Public Works. I am going to make a motion that we give. Assistant Public Works 3% raise, retroactive to the 1st of January.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
I'm going to make a motion that we give Public Works Jesse a 3% raise retroactive to January 1st.
Second.
I do have a discussion on that one. Yeah, I should have brought up, but where's he at with his certifications?
He needs one more test to get his full certifications.
He's definitely stepped it up.
Yes, he just got one within certified. This last quarter, and he just needs one more now, and then he'll be fully certified.
Yeah, he just got to take the test too. Doesn't mean he's,
yeah.
He's going out to Rapid City.
He's going out to Rapid City to do that, yeah, in February here. So
when he gets that, could we give him additional raise later on in the year?
Yep, because if they've got additional certifications, the council in the past has given merit raises, you know, between the annual, so.
That's what caught my attention, so.
Yep.
That's good, thank you.
General labor.
Oh.
Did we vote?
Motion and second.
Yep.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
General labor. I'm going to make a motion that we give 3% raise retroactive January 1st.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Building inspector, I make a motion that we grant 3% raise to the building inspector retroactive January 1st.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
City administrator. I'm going to make a motion. Will we give the city administrator a 9% raise retroactive January 1st?
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
I'm going to make a motion that we adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed, stay here.